in this box, Gordon?
Hey, Adam. This is something I'm pretty excited to see. This is the new, I'm going to get the name right, the Asus Zenbook S13 OLED. That, of course, 13 inches. Zenbook implies thin and light laptop, but the exciting thing, besides the fact that it's the Zenbook, is this is the first Ryzen 7 6800U laptop that I've seen in person that I can actually test. This unit is from AMD's lab, so not from Asus. Want to mention that ahead of time, but the exciting thing is, you know, Ryzen 7000, which we have seen, or Ryzen 6000, sorry, which we have seen already, really kind of surprised everybody. Fantastic performance, super great efficiency, and now we're seeing this probably in where it's really going to shine, in a small, thin, and light laptop. Again, Zenbook UM532T, which is the Zenbook S13 OLED. Yeah, obviously the OLED tells you it's got an OLED, but let's check it out. We're gonna do the unboxing first. Let's look at the power supply. That's what's exciting to me. It tells me a lot. Nice packaging, by the way. Okay, and look, you get, what is
USB-C.
This? USB-C as it should be, and 65 watts. So 65 watt USB power supply, PD, which is great. I mean, I was wondering if, well, are they gonna need a hotter power supply? That's what I'm most curious about. You're also getting a dongle that gives you USB-A. So I'm gonna guess that tells us there is no onboard type A port in the Zenbook S13 OLED. As a Star Trek fan, I do appreciate that this looks a little bit like a Federation symbol. Oh, look at this. Look at this premium feel here.
That looks real thin.
I get my, look at that. Oh, look at this.
Ooh.
This tells us, of course, about the screen. It's a 14.9 millimeter, so very thin. It's an OLED, so you're getting that insane contrast ratio. Also 100% DCI-P3. It is also, we're gonna see it as I open it up, a 1610 aspect ratio screen. You gotta have, if you're gonna have a laptop these days, it's gotta be 1610. The resolution, 1610 OLED is 2880 by 1800. So 1800p resolution screen. Let's turn it on. Oh, and it has touch. They tell you this so that people know it has touch.
Yeah.
Oh. Don't try this at home, Apple users. Doesn't work. So again, 2880 by 1800p OLED panel, DCI P3. 100%. Also, it's a 550-nit screen, so very bright. So that is very useful. That means, you know, you can actually probably use this in bright daylight, although it's not going to be great for battery life.
Well, it's even Pantone certified, too.
Pantone certified, yeah. And then, of course, we have our 10-key. Press and hold, you get your 10-key, your virtual 10-key support if you're into that kind of thing. But a very nice large trackpad. We're going to get into the insides in a sec, but let's do the ports because I know people like to see the ports. The weight of this is 2.2 pounds or just under 1 kilo. You're getting a, oh, look at this. Interesting. They're actually going to give you an analog headset port.
Perfect.
Two USB-Cs. Also, they support, you can see the clearly marked display port and the lightning. Two lightning bolts means, I'm guessing, charge. That doesn't look like the Thunderbolt because it's not necessarily Thunderbolt. We're going to get in that in a second. Let's look on the other side. Oh, and you're getting another. So three USB-C ports. Now, that's great. You can plug this in, but I'm going to tell you one thing that's actually very special about this laptop. This is the first laptop that I've seen in my hands outside of demos that will actually have USB 4 support. And USB 4 support is something you have to go to night school to study to figure out. It basically means you're getting a lot of the features of Thunderbolt rolled into USB 4, you know, up to 40 gigs per second for everything combined. What it probably means that's more exciting for most people is I should be able to take a Thunderbolt drive or an external eGPU enclosure that is using Thunderbolt 3, plug it into this, and I will be able to run external graphics on the Zenbook, which I have not been able to do on any AMD-based laptop so far. I have done that on plenty of Intel laptops because they all have Thunderbolt 3, they have Thunderbolt 4. Apple has Thunderbolt 4 as well in M1 and M1 Max. The Ryzen 7 6800U also has USB 4. Now, again, USB 4 is not Thunderbolt, but it has all of the attributes of Thunderbolt if you do that. And the Zenbook S does actually will have Thunderbolt certification. To do that, I'm going to have to install a beta BIOS. And if you are getting this laptop in June, you should be able to have USB 4 out of the gate. But the cool thing is you're going to get that goodness of external GPU, Thunderbolt performance, plus as well all the USB 4 stuff. That's awesome. But I'm excited for that. And of course, probably more exciting is the CPU for many because it's Ryzen 7 6800U. We're talking about 8 cores, all performance, as AMD would probably say. There's also SMT to give you 16 threads of compute. This particular laptop should have 32 gigs of RAM. Let's check, because the specs didn't look right on the paper that I got. Oh no, okay, 16 gigs. I don't know why they said it was 16 gigs. So it's 16 gigs of LPDDR5, 6400, so pretty decent clocks. 16 gigs is plenty. Also, you're getting RDNA 2 with Radeon graphics, which is Radeon 680M. Should be very nice if you've seen our video on the RDNA 2 and the Radeon 680M. It is a smoking awesome IGP. And also, we are also going to get an actual Gen 4 SSD in this. I have already seen Ryzen 6000 with a Gen 4 drive, but the Gen 4 drive didn't feel like a Gen 4 drive to me. So this is, of course, another nice thing that Intel has had an advantage over AMD. Now AMD has that advantage. So unlike other unboxing videos we have done where I sit down, I run a few tests, we snap back in time and you see the test. I'm actually going to take a few days to run some more tests because we have a little more time for this. So I'm going to run more tests that I normally would not because I'm excited to see how the Ryzen 6000 will perform in a thin and light laptop like this, because Intel still has some really awesome laptops and CPUs in this form factor. I'm interested to see if Ryzen 6000 is really going to do well. I have not, I'm going to say, seen a 12th gen Intel laptop in my hands yet. So I'm going to give you a little bit of what AMD is saying. They're actually saying that they actually can outperform 12th gen Alder Lake in some tests that you would think that Alder Lake would win. I'm going to find out when I run the test myself, but a bit of a surprise. For now, though, stay tuned because we're going to get into some actual performance and some battery life tests on this laptop as well. Hey everybody, so we're back. I've had a few grueling days to test the Asus Zenbook S13 OLED with AMD's new Ryzen 7 6800U with RDNA 2 graphics inside. The results are pretty much what I expected. But I do want to point out before we get too far into this what I'm comparing it to and also what to consider when you're doing laptop comparisons. Well, we are kind of looking at this from the CPU capability. The CPU cannot be looked at in a vacuum like on a desktop. It is also very much about the cooling that's wrapped around it, the laptop that is wrapped around it, as well as what the actual laptop maker has designed that laptop for. And also the three laptops I'm comparing it to. They're all similar class, although I will point out what's probably a few key differences to them. The first one is an MSI Prestige 14 Evo. That is a Tiger Lake Core i7-1195G7 quad core, because that is the best 11th gen Tiger Lake U part there is. I unfortunately have not had a chance to lay my hands on a 12th gen Alder Lake P or Alder Lake U yet. That laptop itself weighs about 1,200 grams or maybe 2.5 pounds, 2.5 pounds, which is exceptionally light. It is a 14-inch laptop screen. The other laptop I'm comparing it to is the older Asus Zenbook 13 OLED, which is sort of the predecessor of this. It has a Ryzen 7 5800U inside of it, 13.3 inches, an OLED, obviously. That laptop is about 1,165 grams, so you could say very similar, you know, 2.4, 2.5 pounds. It has a 67 watt-hour battery. And the last one I'm also going to compare this to is the Lenovo IdeaPad Slim 7, which had the original Ryzen 7 4800U. That is another 8-core Ryzen. That was a 7-nanometer Ryzen 8 cores, which at the time rocked the entire world of Intel. It is in the IDEA pad, it is a slightly bigger, slightly heavier laptop. Again, like the MSI, it is a 14-inch screen, so definitely pretty big, 60 watt-hours, and also it's a pretty hefty laptop at about 1,400 grams. It's basically pushing almost 3 pounds, so it is a very heavy, very feels very heavy, very rugged. Another thing I think you should know about this laptop is at 1,098 grams with a touchscreen, it's actually exceptionally light, because when you add a touchscreen in here, you have to put a layer of glass over that, and that glass generally adds like almost a couple ounces of weight to a laptop. So a lot of the weight from this laptop is actually in the screen. I'm just gonna say it's probably one of the lightest laptops I've seen in a very long time, especially for the performance you're getting out of it. First up, you can see that here. This is Maxon Cinebench R20. It is a 3D rendering benchmark. We see in black, all core usage. The new Ryzen 7 6800U is right in front of everybody at 4048. And I think actually in comparable Ryzen land, the older Zenbook 13 with the Ryzen 7 5000 series is probably closer to it, because it's about the same weight almost. And that's about 3592 versus 4048. In the IdeaPad Slim 7, surprisingly, although not really surprising, because a lot of laptop performance, when you get down to this weight, comes down to how hard you're going to drive the fans, how well you're going to cool that CPU, how much power you're going to give that CPU, that Ryzen 7 4800U is actually faster than the older Ryzen 5000, because it's just simply being driven harder. The fans are running harder on it. It is considerably louder than both Asus laptops, so there's also that. But, you know, honestly, AMD doesn't care about other Ryzen laptops. They only care about Intel. And you could see Tiger Lake, as wonderful of a CPU it was, it's not going to compare 4 cores against 8 cores, and it simply gets crushed in all cores with the 2020 versus 4048. Yeah, that's almost double the performance in this new Ryzen 6000, because, hey, 8 cores versus 4 cores, 6-nanometer process, that was a 10-nanometer process, yada yada, all that stuff. But what's also important, though, as Intel would like to point out, is single threaded matters too, especially in these very thin laptops. The light blue there you're seeing is Cinebench using a single thread of all these laptops, so it doesn't matter whether it's 4 cores or 8 cores. And I would say it's basically a dead tie, which is very good for the Ryzen 6000 versus the Core i7-1195G7, even better. Basically, single-thread performance, very similar across these, although you're definitely giving up a decent amount of single-threaded performance as you get to that 4000 series Ryzen, because that was an older architecture behind it. Up next, I use the current version of Handbrake, which is 1.51, to take a 4K video file and convert it to H.265 using the CPU, and Handbrake generally likes more cores, and you can see the advantage here again goes to Ryzen. And even though we saw advantages for the older Ryzen 7 when it's pushed to really, really high wattage limits, the Zenbook here with the Ryzen 6000 still with a significant performance increase over the Slim 7 with the Ryzen 7 4800U. The Ryzen 7 5800U, which again, I think is probably very comparable because they're similar size laptops, similar thickness. It's got a very good performance increase over that Ryzen 5000. Because remember, the Ryzen 5000, the max TDP was 15 watts. Technically, this is 28 watts. It just is able to hold a higher boost clock, higher than the older Ryzen 5000. And it shows up here in Handbrake, which is an all core load. And of course, all three of these embarrass Intel because more cores are better when you're doing a CPU-based encode. Realistically, though, a lot of people take advantage of the hardware encoders that are built into the graphics on these laptops. So I also used Intel's QuickSync and AMD's VCE to do the same workload. This, of course, is using the hardware acceleration integrated into the newer CPUs. The worst here is the Ryzen 5000, interestingly, and I suspect that may be, again, sort of thermal loads of that very thin laptop, and 15-watt Ryzen 5000 really sort of has a problem, especially against the older Ryzen 4000, which is in that Lenovo IDS Slim 7, the fans are running very, very fast all of the time. But look at that Ryzen 7 6000 here. The 6800U puts a beat down on both the Ryzen 7 5800U and the Ryzen 7 4800U using the media engine. My guess is simply better performance out of the media engine in the RDNA 2 part. And also, we are running LPDDR5, which may give this laptop some advantage over the LPDDR4X in both of those other laptops. Up next is yet another video sort of based test. This is Procyon 2.0. It's a benchmark made by UL, the people who make sure all your electrical items don't burn your house down. Yes, if your extension cord doesn't have a UL hologram sticker on it, you may not want to use it. But I'm not here to shill for UL. I am here to say I use Procyon and its video editing test to look at the performance of these laptops. I would say that's maybe not what most people would use, because are you really doing video editing on a laptop this thin and light? Arguably, though, the amount of performance you're getting out of these laptops makes it actually possible. Higher score is better. And this is very interesting because you're looking at the best score going to the Ryzen 6000. I know some people are getting a little tired of hearing that, but this is a pretty good win for the Ryzen 6000 here. It clearly is outperforming the Ryzen 5000 and the Ryzen 4000 by a significant amount. But Intel and QuickSync, they still got something to say here because it is right behind that Ryzen 7 6800U, and that is a Core i7-1195G7 with only 4 cores. But, you know, again, a lot of things that you are doing in Premiere might use QuickSync. You saw the advantage in Handbrake previously for the Tiger Lake part, and you're probably seeing some of that here, and it really comes down to developer optimizations for CPUs. But clearly, both of these laptops would be very similar in performance in the Procyon benchmark. Up next, though, let's get into something away from video editing, because I know a lot of people saying, well, I'm not really going to do video editing on a 13-inch, 2.2-pound laptop. No, I'm going to do something more normal. First up is UL's PCMark 10. It's a very popular benchmark, and longer bars are better here, and it's an interesting mix. Clearly, Ryzen 5000 or 6000 has a pretty decent edge over 4000. This is actually, despite it doing really well in those sort of like Cinebench and Handbrake, we see it sort of lose pretty handily here to the Ryzen 6000 in these tasks. But interestingly, in digital content creation, actually in productivity and in essentials, I'm actually seeing a little bit of an advantage for the Ryzen 5000. I'm not exactly sure why that is. I really thought it would have been all going to the Ryzen 6000, but there's something where either it's a driver immaturity or whether it's just simply how the laptops are tuned. But overall, though, AMD does win. Ryzen 6000, number one. Ryzen 5000, number two. Ryzen 4000 and Tiger Lake, I would say, kind of a tie. Not everybody uses open source of video editors and open source photo editors. So again, we want to look at practical applications you'd use on a laptop this size. So for that, I use PugetBench. It's a popular benchmark built by a workstation manufacturer up in Washington. The nice thing, it actually is based on real applications. So this is actually using Lightroom Classic and Photoshop, and we're ranked first the Intel Tiger Lake, second is Ryzen 6000, 5000, then the 5000, then the 4000. You know, again, these applications tend to be very lightly threaded. In Photoshop and Lightroom Classic, the advantage actually goes to the Tiger Lake part, because apparently all of the cores in the Ryzens don't give it an advantage here. And I will say Ryzen 6000, though, was the fastest of the AMD laptops, and it's really a 1-2-3 finish from there. Tiger Lake has some legs left on it still, but Ryzen 6000, still very respectable. I mean, that is a very close number two, I'd say. One thing I will say about using Photoshop and Lightroom as an application, and especially these benchmarks, is they basically create a bunch of scripts. They run you through them. When you have a suite as large as Photoshop and Lightroom Classic, and you have so many photographers doing so many different things, it may not always match what you're doing. So I get a second opinion from Procyon 2.0. This is their photo editing benchmark. It again uses the same version of Adobe Photoshop, the same version of Adobe Lightroom Classic, but it does very different things than we were doing in the PugetBench. And here we are, we're looking at the heads and above winner in batch processing, which is Lightroom Classic, is the Ryzen 5000 and the Ryzen 6000. I would say those are pretty much a tie between both of those parts. This is actually interesting because I thought I would have seen these, both of these laptops do better against the Tiger Lake in Lightroom in the previous PugetBench, but it didn't, because Lightroom tends to have a portion of it that, when you do exports, favors more cores. More cores gives you more performance, but we are definitely seeing the advantage go to both of the 8-core Ryzen 5000 and 6000s here. And the in batch processing, in fact, the Tiger Lake is slightly slower, but essentially tied with the Ryzen 4000. So despite the Ryzen 4000 having double the amount of cores as the Tiger Lake, it's just barely faster than it. When we look at the image retouch performance, again, same colors, the winner, surprisingly, is actually, again, a Ryzen 5000. It's not really clear to me why this is, whether this is just simply drivers that are just simply not working quite right with Photoshop, because there is some OpenCL, OpenGL performance that you're getting out of Photoshop, but it's kind of bewildering to see the Ryzen 6000 slightly slower here than the Ryzen 5000, considering for most of everything it's been winning. The winner, though, in Photoshop, and I will say this is probably the truth most of the time, is Intel's Core i7-1195G7 Tiger Lake. Even though it's got quad cores, Photoshop, for most of what you do, is going to really just lean on one or two cores, maybe three threads, and Tiger Lake's ability to hit very, very high clocks, and also the processor optimizations done by Adobe, the same ones they happen to do for Apple, really benefit Intel. I know, for example, there is one filter here that is very popular that is heavily optimized for Intel architecture. I know people will say, boo-hoo, that's not fair, but if you're going to use Photoshop and use that filter, you only care about what's better for you. Moving on to more boring things, I'm going to look at office performance. This is using, again, Procyon. I love this benchmark because it basically uses Office 365. You install Office 365. It looks at Outlook, PowerPoint, Excel, and Word performance running all four of those applications at the same time. Not simultaneously, but they're sort of your multitasking. And again, this is something I think is actually very important for a laptop of this class. Most people are not buying this thin and light laptop to do, say, 3D modeling on them. They are doing Office, they are doing Photoshop, and we can see, again, that big advantage that Tiger Lake has here. Again, very high clocks, very high boost on Tiger Lake, and it's got a very hefty advantage in Outlook. It's got a big advantage in PowerPoint. If you're all about Word, it's going to be Ryzen 6000, which actually has a nice bump in performance over the Tiger Lake part. It also has a nice performance advantage over the Ryzen 5000 and 4000. What exactly is going on in there, I don't know. I'd have to sit down and spend a month to try to figure out, but all I know is if you're doing a mail merge, like a Mo, like top-end mail merge, you're gonna want Ryzen 6000. Tiger Lake number one, Ryzen 5000 number two, Ryzen 6000 are very close number two. You could say it's close enough to be a tie. Ryzen 4000, not horrible, but clearly holding up a very distant fourth place. So this is actually a very important test because, honestly, let's admit it, you're at work. Most of the time, you ain't working. If you're like me, you're just browsing the internet for work, right? So let's find out what's fastest. For that, I installed Google. This is Chrome 100. I run four popular benchmarks, WebExpert, Jetstream, Speedometer, and MotionMark. These are all publicly available. You can run them if you have Chrome installed on your laptops. I would say, for the most part, not a huge difference. You know, clearly the winner, though, interestingly, I'm not surprised, is Tiger Lake. Again, very, very high clocks. Most of what you're doing in browsing doesn't really need 8 cores and 16 threads. And Tiger Lake is kind of a CPU that is really well tuned for those very light loads. You know, we do want to get into the gaming portion here, because I do think if you're looking at some of these laptops, you know, you might want to play some light duty gaming. I ran a bunch of games, real games, at 1080p resolution. First up is Dirt 5, then Rainbow Six Siege, Hitman 3, and then Shadow of the Tomb Raider at medium and Shadow of the Tomb Raider at low. So I don't really need to run 25 games, but you can clearly see that the advantage mostly is going to go to RDNA 2. And when you're looking at a game like Rainbow Six Siege, it's a huge advantage over Iris Xe. Looking at Dirt 5 performance, though, we run into the normal Intel problem where, like, you know, Intel's still got to work on its drivers. Intel is a newcomer to actually game drivers. In this benchmark, I had no problems in any of the Ryzen laptops running it. The zero for that Dirt 5 score, though, is because with the Intel laptop, it simply stopped running in the middle of the benchmark. I could never complete it. And Intel's drivers, they're going to have to improve. This is something that if Intel really wants to be a serious player in gaming, they really have to step it up in gaming. RDNA 2 is an amazing integrated graphics to be able to get in, whether it's a thin and light laptop like this, whether it's a Steam Deck, and it really does change the bar for what kind of gaming you can get out of a 2.2-pound laptop. Okay, our last benchmark result is perhaps the most important. This is basically battery life. I'm actually still gonna do more, a heavier look into battery life and performance, but right now I'm gonna do our standard battery benchmark run, which is looping a 4K video in airplane mode with earbuds on, with the screen set to a reasonably bright 250 to 260 nits. We basically loop this video until the laptop dies. Obviously, the longer the runtime, the better. So we have the battery sizes listed for the laptops here. It's 52 hours for the Intel laptop, 67 watt hours for both of the Zenbooks, and 60 watt hours for the Lenovo laptop. Actually, all three of those other laptops are the same resolution, basically 1080p. The Zenbook with the Ryzen 5000, though, does have an OLED panel, as does this, but this panel is 2880 by 1800p, and we are looking at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, almost 16 hours of video runtime on this laptop. That's quite a bit more than the Ryzen 5000, which was a little bit of a shocker to me. The IdeaPad actually does fairly decently. And you know, honestly, I would say the Tiger Lake, that MSI, is not bad. 11 hours is decent, especially when you consider that it's a 52-watt-hour battery, which is considerably smaller than a 67-watt-hour battery. Clearly, this Ryzen 6000 with the OLED panel in the Asus Zenbook S13 OLED is just, it's got all kinds of crazy battery life for video runtime. So the last couple things I'm gonna talk about. One is very important, and of course that is because this laptop has USB 4 performance. I said I'd get into the USB 4 aspect of it because USB 4 is a brave new world to everybody. Unfortunately, today I don't really have the final word on it yet, although it is promising, and that is because the Thunderbolt 3 devices that I've tried on this laptop, which should in theory work, did not work. I tried no less than 4 different Thunderbolt-based devices on here. None of them worked. And I know people are going to be very disappointed, but I will say it's very encouraging because when I plug them in, they actually enumerated within the device manager. So typically when I take Thunderbolt 3 devices that don't have any USB and I plug them into laptops like a standard USB-C port with only USB and no Thunderbolt, nothing happens. On this laptop, it actually shows up OWC drive, or this drive, this eGPU, or this network controller. Unfortunately, the device didn't go any further, and I think it's because the drivers just aren't quite there yet. In fact, just as I was starting to record this, AMD sent over yet another BIOS and another update for USB PD. They think it's the reason why some of the devices aren't quite showing up there. So I am very encouraged that I think by the time you can actually buy this laptop, you will be able to plug in a Thunderbolt 3-based eGPU, a Thunderbolt 3-based network controller or drive, and actually have it function over Thunderbolt 3. It's just been something you've not been able to get on any AMD laptop so far. I still have not seen a Thunderbolt-based laptop, and again, it's because they wanted to do USB 4, because essentially USB 4 is Thunderbolt. It should make it work with Thunderbolt. If the laptop maker is certified for it, this laptop is supposed to be certified for Thunderbolt 3, so it should function no different than any other Apple or Intel-based laptop that has Thunderbolt in it. Unfortunately, I just can't talk about it today, but we are going to make it work because I'm so excited to see USB 4 using Thunderbolt devices actually work. The other thing I want to talk about is the laptop itself. You've heard me say this before, and I just want to keep saying this. This laptop is spectacularly light. It's 1,100 grams, which is about 2.4 pounds. It's probably one of the lightest laptops I've seen in a long time. I have seen lighter, but those laptops, their performance stunk. So this is a 2.4 pound laptop, 1,100 grams, that performs like a 4 and 5 pound laptop used to. So you're getting a spectacular amount of performance in a very light laptop. Also, this OLED. I love 1610 aspect ratio. I also like high DPI, not 4K, because that's a little too high, but this is a really great high DPI panel. It's also OLED. OLEDs are just beautiful. If you've ever used an OLED, it's hard to go back to anything else. It's also really bright too, at about 550 nits. You're getting a really bright panel. So the panel's beautiful. You have also the keyboard is also really improved over the previous version, the previous Zenbook OLED. In fact, the one I'm comparing this to with the Ryzen 5000, all kinds of performance. And had an atrocious keyboard. The keyboard was just very compact because it had a pretty small frame. This being a 1610 laptop with a taller screen means the entire laptop body is a little bit longer, and this keyboard is now fully usable, whereas I really had a problem with the very compressed keyboard in the previous version of it. So battery life great, screen is great, stupidly light. You're getting insane amount of performance, insane amount of, you know, gaming performance considering the weight of this laptop, the laptop class is in, and USB 4 still will come. It does have a headset jack, good job. There's no USB-A, which just still kills me. Asus does give you a USB-A adapter, but it just kills me because every time you pick up an old school USB drive and you left your dongle upstairs, you left in your bag, or your coworker stole it, because all your coworkers will always steal your dongles. That's how you get them. That's how I got my last three. I just stole them from my coworkers. That's how you get them. Well, somebody stole those. Then you got this key, you can't plug it in, and you're just screwed. And it makes you head slap. I know why everybody's doing this. Dell has done this. Asus is doing this because this laptop is thin. Look how thin this sucker is. It's light, it's thin, it's stupidly thin, but okay, well just make a drop-down jaw. I just came back from New York, I saw an HP laptop, they made a drop-down to do your A. Just do it. I mean, we're not there yet. We just can't go full Apple. Never go full Apple. PC makers, don't go full Apple until it's time, so please don't do it yet. Put the USB-A back on there. The other one feedback I want to give on this laptop, 65 watt power brick, very nice. It's USB-C, runs on any USB-C charger, of course. I'm not sure what's up with this. This has a fixed charging brick. Most prongs will fold down because this is just fixed, which is nice because it's a little more sturdy. It's not gonna break off, but it's just annoying to have this thing not fold down because I'm just so used to this folding down. So a little bit of negative feedback there for me on that. So USB-A, I'd love to see. And also the folding prongs, but this laptop, pretty amazing. I'm gonna tell you the price with 16 gigs of LPDDR5 6400, Ryzen 7 6800U, RDNA 2 graphics, 1 terabyte NVMe 4.0 SSD Samsung, and the 2880 by 1800 OLED panel, $1,449, which, you know, is a little, it's definitely a premium laptop, but you are getting so many premium features. You're getting, we're almost there to Thunderbolt 4 performance, Thunderbolt 3 performance out of a USB 4 port. You're getting spectacular performance all around. This really is just a wonderful laptop to have, especially if you want your portability, you want your lightness, you want your beautiful high DPI screen, and you want it in a small laptop. This is gonna be very hard to beat. Again, the shoot-a-drop will be Alder Lake, But I'm going to tell you, for most people, this is a spectacular laptop to have. So for more laptop coverage and to see me finally make a Thunderbolt 3 drive work with USB 4, come back to PC World's YouTube page and go to PCWorld.com.